organizing committee for this opportunity. The focus of this talk is the surgical treatment of pelvic bone malignancies in the pediatric population. Although multidisciplinary therapies and multi-agent chemotherapy have improved local control and overall survival in sarcoma, the prognosis for pelvic lesions remains markedly worse than that of limb sarcoma. There are typical and significant difficulties in the surgical treatment of bone tumors involving the pelvis, and even more so when the tumors, when the lumbar spine is involved in addition. Because of the complex anatomical location, achieving oncologically safe margins while maintaining reasonable functional outcome and acceptable morbidity is a significant challenge. I will use three example cases of our recent experience for the demonstration of typical dilemmas in the treatment of these conditions. These cases are fundamentally different from one another, and they each represent other characteristic scenario. So three basic questions have to be answered in order to decide about the appropriate therapeutic plan for each patient. First, is there advantage for surgical treatment for this specific patient? Second, if surgical treatment is decided, then should the limb be sacrificed or is it oncologically safe to salvage the limb? And third, if limb-sparing surgery is decided, then is it better to reconstruct the bone deficit that will be left after the resection? For the first question, this is a quote from the NIH guidelines. In the past, more peripheral tumors, smaller tumors were more likely to be treated with surgery, and larger, more central tumors were more likely to be treated with radiation therapy. Today, if the lesion is resectable, then surgery is generally the preferred approach, regardless of the lesion size or site. So that's for the first question, the surgical versus non-surgical issue. The second question is whether to sacrifice the involved limb or to spare it. In a modern sarcoma surgery area, it was shown that the oncologic outcome could be the same for limb-sparing surgery and an amputation in appropriate settings. The necessary condition for a limb-sparing surgery is the ability to achieve adequate surgical margins while preserving vascular supply and innervation. In the past, the surgical treatment for pelvic sarcoma was amputation of the involved hemipelvis with the lower limb, what is referred to as hind quarter amputation, or an external hemipelvectomy, like the image on the left. Of course, an operation of this type has a very poor functional outcome. The limb-sparing surgery analog for this surgery is the internal hemipelvectomy, the resection of the involved pelvic segment with preservation of the lower limb. Internal hemipelvectomy is classified according to the level of the osteotomies, as shown on the right image. So next is the third question. Should a reconstruction of the bone deficit left after the resection be done, or should it be left without any reconstruction? The decision for this issue is also challenging. The complication risk for reconstruction in these operations is high, mainly infectious complications. These three examples of recent studies about the reconstruction dilemma demonstrate the lack of consensus on this issue. Some believe that the functional outcome benefit of reconstruction in these settings is not significant compared to the same type of internal hemipelvectomy without a reconstruction. Others conclude the opposite, that reconstructions after internal hemipelvectomy offer better functional outcome with a reasonable complication rate. So I'll review these example cases from our recent experience according to these principles. First is the case on the left. This is an otherwise healthy 15-year-old male patient diagnosed with undifferentiated sarcoma involving the pelvis without any secondary spread on presentation. You can see the extent of the soft tissue mass going cranialward into the pelvis and distalwards into the thigh. This is an axial image that demonstrates the tumor crossing the midline. Not sure if you see the pointer, so it crosses the midline, abuts the bladder, very close to the external iliac vessels. Here you can see the involvement of the supraacetabular bone. The tumor crossed the symphysis pubis to involve the contralateral pubic body. and very close to delicate pelvic structures, including the vas deferens, the ischiorectal pouch, and so on. So the main difficulties in this case is the proximity to important anatomical structures that limit the extent of the surgical margins, the acetabular involvement that in case of surgery, some kind of reconstruction will need to be done, and so on. And the main three questions, as I mentioned earlier, are those questions: whether to go on with surgery, whether to do a limb-sparing surgery, and whether to reconstruct it. The decision was to continue with the surgery. You can see the specimen shown here. You can see the acetabulum, the healthy soft tissue that was sacrificed as margins around the tumor. This is the type of reconstruction that we decided to do. This is except this kind of a reverse ice cream cone reconstruction for the acetabulum. The rest of the reconstruction is quite similar to a conventional arthroplasty. You can see the supraacetabular osteotomy and the contralateral superior and inferior pubis osteotomies. This is the functional outcome a year post-op. Sorry, just a second. So this is around a year post-op. Oncologically, the patient is very well with negative margins and good necrosis percentage. So for the second example case, the image on the middle is that of a 15-year-old male patient diagnosed with undifferentiated sarcoma involving the lumbar spine and pelvis. It differs from the last case by the level of pelvic involvement, in this case supraacetabular, and by the involvement of the L4 and L5 vertebrae. Again, no secondary spread on presentation. The soft tissue component is shown here on axial imaging. You can see the involvement of the right side of the L5 vertebra. Here you can see the penetration of the tumor into the L4, L5 foramina on the right and the L5, S1 foramina on the right. And here you can see the involvement of the upper component of the lumbosacral plexus on the right compared to the uninvolved side on the left. So this is a preoperative planning. The bony involved components are highlighted in red, and the planned osteotomies are highlighted in blue. So the main difficulties here is the involvement of the L4-5 vertebra, the hemisacrum, the ilium, the large volume of the soft tissue component, both intrapelvic and extrapelvic, and of course the involvement of the lumbosacral nerve plexus that raises the question of continence postoperatively, motor function, and so on. The same three questions are the basis for the discussion. So this kind of resection is referred to as spinopelvic resection. In this case, a type 1+4 right extended hemipelvectomy with an L4 and L5 right hemicorpectomy or hemivertebrectomy. So there's no conventional way to reconstruct such a case. We decided to reconstruct it with a personalized 3D printed titanium implant that will be fixed to the supraacetabular osteotomy, as shown here, with a posterior column and anterior column long screws, will be fixed to the contralateral sacrum, will be connected by this handle on the back to a conventional fixation system along the lumbar spine. These are the images of the planned implant. This is the specimen. You can see the mid-sagittal osteotomy of L4, L5, S1, and S2, the supraacetabular osteotomy. This is the contralateral side, the L4, L5, S1, and S2. This is the dual sac, the sutured nerve roots that were sacrificed because of involvement in the tumor. This is the implant. This is the posterior view of the implant connected to the fixation system along the lumbar spine and in situ anterior view of the implant.
Please get to the end of the presentation.
So these are intraoperative imaging studies, and the patient is oncologically very well with negative margins and good necrosis percentage. Of course, there's a neurologic deficit in the distribution of the nerve that were sacrificed. So the last short example is that of this 13-year-old female patient diagnosed with Ewing sarcoma involving the pelvis on the right. Imaging studies here demonstrate the pelvic tumor mass involving the acetabulum, ischium, inferior ramus, and pubic body. The soft tissue component crosses the midline, pressing against the vaginal wall without a separating plane and completely encasing the urethra. And metastatic lesions are demonstrated on the contralateral femur and contralateral inferior ramus. So this patient had the metastatic disease on presentation and the tumor encased important pelvic viscera. In this case, we assume that there is no real option for a true negative margin resection with a reasonable morbidity. The patient was referred abroad for advanced radiotherapy technique. And I mentioned this case to emphasize that even with all recent advancements, surgery is still not appropriate in every case. So to summarize, pelvic bone malignancies in children present complex challenges. The decision sometimes reaches philosophical levels. What is a reasonable functional outcome? What is an acceptable morbidity and so forth? Thank you for the attention.